Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN Podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined this week by a newcomer in Scottish wrestling. I'm joined by the Phoenix, Colton Davis. How you doing?
I'm good, how are you?
I'm not too bad. It's still a bit of a weird time. You're now my second interview in 2021, as I pull back the curtain here, as always, because I can't keep my mouth shut and tell everyone when I do these scheduling things. So I'm getting back in the swing of things. Had about an hour chat with Shady and just get back in the rhythm of things of doing interviews. So I'm really excited about speaking to yourself because our first season was a lot of newcomers and folk that didn't actually even have matches. But I know you've had quite a few matches now in Source Wrestling. So we'll go with the boring question and just go out from there. How did you get into pro wrestling?
So when I was probably about five or so, it was always kind of on in the background. I think my dad watched it kind of, not to any real length. He didn't follow it, but it was on in the background. And the first kind of full show I watched was the Royal Rumble in 2008, where Cena come back and won the Rumble. And from then it was just kind of, I was hooked on that. I watched the WrestleMania the following April or something, and that was it. From there, I've just always watched. It was kind of on and off, back when I was like 6, 7. But I've always watched wrestling in some capacity, especially WWE in the younger years.
So that's automatically make me feel old, because that's 2008. I was 18. The year I remember that, 2008, the Cena return, of course, that was huge. I stayed up. Royal Rumble's the one I try to stay up for, except this last year where I've stayed up for all of them because I work from home at the moment, so it's great. But 2008 especially, Jeff Hardy versus Randy Orton for the WWE title, and that was the whole build-up to Jeff not being able to make the big one, and then Armageddon 2008, him actually winning the title. What a year. So 2008 is when you started. Any favourites? Cena, would he be one of your favourites, seeing him, or just growing up?
Yeah, it was like, I think the three mains would be Cena, just for the kind of return. I was like, he looks like he knows what he's doing. He's a big lad. And then like Jeff Hardy, obviously he automatically draws you in with his unique look. He's not 6'7" and 300 pounds of muscle and looks like he's chiseled out of stone. He's a bit unique, very different, and his matches are unreal, some of the things he's done. And then another was Randy Orton, which has always been, he's been the one kind of consistent, which is strange because not many five-year-olds like the bad guy. But for some reason, I don't know what it was, but he's always been one of, if not my favourite, and he has been my favourite of all time. Those three were the main ones,
Definitely a big, wide berth of characters as well, because you've got Cena, the powerhouse. He's the big guy who just flings people about, really. And then you got Orton, slow, methodical. Yep. Everything makes sense. There's logic. And then you got Jeff Hardy, who just does everything. So that means your first taste of Jeff Hardy, so to speak, from 2008, that would have been Mike Adamley. I don't know if you've ever went back to listen to him calling him Jeff Harvey. So that's 2008. That means you started right through Mike Adamley's time in WWE. I'm going to go back and watch 2008. That's my plan this weekend, next weekend. I'm going to do that.
Some roster back then.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, when you go back, I'm just going from memory, because this is January's around about time I watch Raw Rumbles, because it's Raw Rumble season. That's when you watch them all.
Yeah.
2008, you would have had Umaga. You would have had Roddy Piper was in that Rumble. Because of course he was.
And so was was it Snuka?
It was Snuka, yeah. You had Foley, Hornswoggle turned up. Absolute weird time. So Jeff Hardy seems to be popping up quite a lot. It doesn't matter what age, he seems to be able to. Everyone seems to just gravitate to Jeff Hardy. I don't know if it is that uniqueness, like you say. He's just has something. He was my favourite growing up, to the point where I actually got a Hardy Boys tattoo.
Uh-huh. So wow. That's cool.
That's dedication or stupidity. Yeah. Who knows? So what I know from you, so I haven't actually seen you wrestle yourself. I think there's probably some matches on YouTube. Is you're a big lad, as in tall. Yep. And but you're not a big guy wrestler, as in you're not like the power guy. From your interview you had with us in the past, you mentioned guys like Dominic Dijakovic, so that kind of hybrid power guy. So did you do any sports before you started training, or what was your kind of athletic background before beginning sports wrestling?
I've done a bit of everything, really. The main one was football. I played football since probably about the same time I got into wrestling, 5, right up until I was 16, I think quite about a year and a half ago, or wrestling. I've played darts. Don't know how I got into that one, but I've played darts, boxing, karate. I just kind of tried a bit of everything. And then it got to the point where 16, I had exams, I got a job, and I had wrestling and football. I said, right, okay, what one did I go for? And it was a no-brainer. I didn't play football at any high level. It was purely just for fun. It was like, could I make it as a pro footballer? No. Could I make it to a decent standard of being a professional wrestler? I think possibly. So, and I enjoyed wrestling more. So I was like, we'll put football to the side. I've enjoyed it. It's been good playing it for like 12 years or whatever it was. So yeah, I hung up the football boots and picked up the wrestling ones.
I suppose as well, you said that you could make a get to a decent level in wrestling. It is a very much a smaller pool. Even though there's like, I don't know, off the top of my head, 16 promotions in Scotland, quite a lot, and there's quite a lot of people vying for spots. There is. Football, millions play it. Thinking they're going to be the next Ronaldo or show my knowledge of football here. I started watching in around about 2003, so it was last time I watched football.
Make you feel old.
What made you decide then to actually go pursue wrestling? And was it the source you started off with, or did you try a couple of places beforehand?
I don't really know. Like, source, it's always been source, but I never said I want to be a professional wrestler, possibly because I didn't really think it was like a realistic thing for someone, a boy who lived in Glasgow. And then I don't know, I just kind of stumbled across it on Facebook when I was 15. And for whatever reason, it took me like 6 months to work up the courage to ask my parents. And there was no reason for me to be nervous to ask them. I was just like, they're going to say no. And eventually I asked them, they're like, yeah, okay. So I was like, cool. But like, I live very close to the Source Wrestling School. All my life I've lived here, and I had no idea that it was there. No idea. And like, I was on Facebook one day, and it was like, there's a wrestling school in Altos Retail Park, which is a stone's throw away. So that it was quite a surprise. But I mean, I'm very lucky, because I know some people travel a long while for training. One that comes to mind who's been doing really well is Ryan Richards. He would travel, I think it was a 6-hour round trip to come down to Source. I was very, very lucky.
Yeah, I mean, I've heard from guys, I spoke to Bradley Poole, who's now Mayhem Brooks. He used to travel from up my end of the town where I live, Elgin, all the way down to Glasgow, Barhead, Airdrie, wherever. But 3 hours there to go down, then 3 hours back. So that's just, I don't have that commitment. I mean, the nearest school I've got is probably an hour and a half away. I'm like, no, I'm all right. But yeah, it's just good that you've got a company that's a school that's held in such high regard as well, just across the road. What was it like taking that first bump then?
Bad. Like, I'd built myself up for it so much. Like, I was so excited to get in there, and I was like, at the back of my mind, I was like, I might not like this. But when I got in and I took the bump, it was like, anybody that knows, it just shakes you right through. And I was like, oh, that was bad. I'm not too sure I want to do this. But I just kind of persevered, and you kind of get used to it. But the worst one for me was rope running. That was very bad. That was worse than the bumps for me, because I was like, I'm still skinny now, but I was very skinny when I started. And running ropes, it was just my spine against it. It was, nah, it was not fun. Not fun.
So me being 6 foot six, am I right in thinking that you're 6 foot six? You'd also have to do quite a lean as well to get under the rope, I would think. Yeah. And especially what standard rings in Scotland are what, I don't know, 14 foot?
Yeah.
You're just about half the size of the ring as well. Was there a big learning curve? Did you have to get extra kind of pointers how to work as a bigger guy around the ring, not just in the actual wrestling moves itself, but how to move yourself?
Yeah. With the ropes, I think I was told to think, the one person I was told to think about was the Undertaker. Because when you see him, he's leaning, he's like halfway across the ring and he's already leaning into the ropes. Because I was just kind of trying to do the Rey Mysterio stand up, hit the ropes, and that wasn't working for me. So it was really lean into it. And it looks better. If you hit the ropes hard, it looks better. If you lean into it, it looks better. Ring awareness took a while. I'm used to playing a football pitch, which is ginormous, big field. And then this small, compact space, it took a bit of getting used to, but in the end, I kind of got there.
So you said Undertaker was one guy you had to look at. Was there anyone else that you were kind of pointed towards to get your style or at least your motions in order?
So I knew that I didn't want to be a big guy, like wrestle like a big guy, because it wasn't believable. Like, I was very skinny. If I was going against anybody who was anywhere near the same size as me, they would more than likely be a lot like broader than me, and it wouldn't be realistic me throwing them about and stuff. So I was told to look at guys. Chris Brooks is one. He's kind of same size as me. Chris Brooks was one. And then, obviously, as you said, Dijakovic, he's a big guy in both ways, but still the way he kind of incorporates two styles into one. Those were the two main guys, I would say.
One that I just came to mind when you were speaking about that, Baron Corbin as well, probably. He's quite that bigger guy, but doesn't work as a power guy. He's like that weird hybrid kind of thing. Yeah. Cool. I mean, we've got some questions here. I'm just going to just rattle, because one we've kind of spoken about already, which is from Manlon. He asked, why are you so tall? Is your parents tall? Are your parents tall?
I get my height from my mum's side of the family. Mum's kind of tall. She's tall for a woman. She's 5'10 or something, which I get told is tall for a woman. I think that is. But her two brothers are like 6'4 plus, so that's what I get it from.
Well, to put that in perspective, I'm 5'10, so that's my height. That's pretty much as your mum said there. So we'll go back to source for it, just because that's where it's where you've been wrestling. So how long did you go from training to actually do one of the matches? I'm assuming it would have been a showcase you would have done first of all.
It took quite a while. It took longer than I would have hoped. I had other commitments, school was the main one, at the exams and things like that. So I debuted coming up for a year, which still blows my mind. I've had two matches in my first year. And I started training in mid to end 2018. So, yeah. Some people take longer, some people don't take as long. Like the boys I debuted with, Darren Jay Blair and AJ Diaz, they'd been wrestling for a little over a year, which is pretty mad. And then Jack Ripley, he'd been wrestling longer than me, so it just kind of depends on the person.
So would that be just about your class when you started, or is there anyone else that's currently active that you started with in your training in 2018?
So the way Source works, we do intake classes, so you have to go through a 6 week get you used before you go into like the classes with the rest of the school. I'm the only one left from my class. It was like eight, and they've all just kind of dropped off one by one. So it's just me from my kind of start. But Jack Ripley started a couple of months before me, so we've kind of been training together for a wee while.
So after that first match, of course, it would be against around friends and family if it's a showcase show, as it usually is. Was there any nerves coming out for that first match, whether you may forget something or just what were your first thoughts going into that first match?
I woke up on the morning, shaking, physically shaking. I was like, nah, I can't do this. But I was lucky in the way that I was told 2 days before that I was going to be debuting because someone had pulled out. So I think if I had like a couple of weeks, I'd have been a nervous wreck for like those weeks. So it was just like, you get 2 days, you just go, you just need to do it. As I got to the day went on, I got more and more nervous until we were stood behind the curtain. And it was like, this is it. You've been training to do this for over like a year and a half. You've watched this since you were 5 years old. This is it. Just go out and enjoy yourself. Thankfully, it was a six man as well, so I didn't have a great deal to do. But I was still nervous. I was like, well, if I forget something, like, just breathe. And as soon as I stepped out, it was like, it just felt right. There was no nerves. My dad was in, mom and dad and my brother. There was a lot of people in the crowd. And my dad had said to my mum, I found this out afterwards, I think after the first match they seen, he was like, he said to my mum, he's not going to be able to do that because I'm not a outgoing person, really. He's like, he's not going to be able to go out there and say this and perform. And I just went out and I could see his face. He was like, who on earth is that? Because it's not me. It's not the way I usually am.
I could segue to my next question beautifully there because usually when I say the first match and I say, how do you feel? My next question is, are you an outgoing person? So, because of course, most of wrestling is the performance. So it's actually getting the crowd on side or against you, whichever it may be. So your dad said you're shy, you're not very outgoing, you said yourself there. So what was it like just getting the crowd involved, or was it a little bit easier because you were only a part of that six man?
I'm not shy, but I'm not in my circles. I'm outgoing, but like with other, I just kind of keep myself to myself if it's people that I don't know or whatever. But when you get to know me, I'm a bit more. It's strange. It's just everything. As soon as I stepped out there, it was like, because I was kind of worried, I was like, am I going to be able to shout and try and get the crowd into it? But nah, it just naturally happened. And it wasn't until after, I was like, I can't really believe that I actually done that, because I don't have a background in any theatre or drama or anything like that. I'd never done anything like it before. Hated drama in school. Never done any school shows or anything like that. So it was just, it was a pleasant surprise when it just kind of happened.
I think it's a strange thing. I mean, I've fully done talking bits. I've mentioned them. I've talked about loads. I've very few wrestling stories, so I have to go back to the old ones. But once you're out there and you're in the ring, you're in control, I find. So if you go in there with confidence, or at least some sort of confidence, the crowd's, has to believe you because you believe it. If you go in there hunched over, nervous, gibbering and all that, the crowd will just eat you alive. Yeah. So it's just as long as you go in confident, like you say, once in a while you clicked, it's really difficult to not, unless you're totally rubbish in the ring, but it's difficult not to get the crowd on side with you. So Manlon's also asked, any story behind the ring name? So you're the Phoenix Colton Davis. What was behind the moniker and the name itself?
So again, it was like before debuting, I didn't know what my name was going to be. Like, I didn't have it predetermined. So when I told I was debuting, I didn't even think about it. It wasn't until I got home, I was like, I need a name. So I sat with my mum and dad, and my dad was coming up with some ridiculous name. He was like, call yourself Big Mac. I was like, no. Mum said Big Daddy. I think that's been you. So Colton is the name of a banjo player in a Canadian folk music band that my dad likes. So I thought, no, I don't really know anybody in Scotland called Colton. We'll roll with that. And Davis kind of fitted with it. Phoenix, I was actually going to be called Colton Phoenix. I thought that sounded too kind of American. like, I'm from Glasgow, that doesn't really, Colton Phoenix doesn't really make sense. So, like, the Phoenix, I can't remember, someone said, what about the Phoenix Colton Davis? And I was like, yeah, why not?
So I love that you actually asked your parents, because I find, like, I know my dad anyway, and I'm assuming your dad would be the same. If you came out with a ridiculous name, he would come out with a million ways for fans to take the mickey out of it. Because I know when I'm thinking of, like, I know, future kids' names, as soon as someone mentions a name, I'm thinking, right, how can the kids mock this? And I'm Billy. I was a very easy target for my name as well. But, yeah, so So a little bit of a tribute to your dad as well as kind of.
Yeah.
And I'm just imagining Colton Phoenix coming out and just a bit of a cowboy kind of thing, just because you're thinking Americanized. And
yeah.
So, like, I mean, there's worse names, I suppose. So you did Source. You were doing Source until, of course, the world ended. And could still be the case when this goes out in February, as of recording, we're going into lockdown at midnight tonight for a nationwide lockdown.
Yeah, fantastic,
exciting. So you've had a few matches now. Any highlights? What's been your kind of highlight so far? Was just starting, just getting to do it.
All of it, really. Like, the debut, obviously, will always be special, like, getting to do it with my friends as well, myself, Darren, Jack and AJ trained together since they started a year in the lead up, and we were always friends and trained together and whatnot, so that'll always be special. And there's a picture that I love. We're obviously on different teams, but at the end of it, the four of us got in the ring, and there was a brilliant picture of the four of us that I'll never forget. So that was a very special moment. And then my second match was against Robert Wishart, which, again, he's been about for quite a bit, and he was one of my trainers, so to go in there with him, test myself, as someone after the match had said, one of the best in the UK, and I do believe that, underrated. And, yeah, to be able to go in there with someone like him, who's been around for so long, taught me quite a bit as well, so to be able to test myself in there was really good, yeah.
Yeah, and of course, Robbie, as of last year, is now one of the co-owners, or at least one of the head trainers at Source now. Yes. Must be really great, like, wrestling someone like Robbie, who is just one of those guys that can just do just about anything, flippy-wise. And of course, you'd be a big 6'6" guy. Must be just a thrill just to be able to not do anything you want with them, so to speak, but, like, having that opportunity to be that base to someone that good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So is that the two matches you've had any more since then? Or was that your...
No, it was just those two. There was ones planned that unfortunately never got to happen. I was due to have a match with Darren in April, and then it was supposed to be myself and Darren against Airstrike, Jack Ripley and AJ Diaz at the Respect Pro gala in Lochwinnock. Unfortunately, that never got to happen either. So hopefully we'll get the chance to have both of those matches whenever we get back. But
fingers crossed. So, yeah, the world ended in March 2020. How have you been keeping yourself busy? Have you been training, just finding ways to train and keep yourself active?
Yeah, so, like, the first main lockdown, that was obviously the worst, and we've had periods of freedom since then. The first one was just the same as everybody, trying to keep, because it was the first time obviously we'd faced a situation like that. Now we're somewhat used to it, some people. But yeah, it was just, I've thankfully got an alright setup there, treadmill, multi-gym in a couple of weeks, so I was able to keep myself active as well as running. And Source is known for their body weight workouts, so I was well equipped knowledge-wise for that. Other than the exercise, I'm still at school, so I've been had that, and I'm working as well, so I've been able to keep myself busy.
So a lot of people that are listening, perhaps, may not have heard your name until our stupidity of tournaments on Twitter, where you teamed with Rain, thanks to the magic hat of me drawing nicknames.
That's fun.
So again, you said you're shy, not around new people and all that kind of thing. So social media seems to be the way a lot of wrestlers at the moment have had to keep their name out there as well as themselves fit. So you entered the tournament and then you teed up with Rain. What were your thoughts going into that? Because it's a different environment. It's not wrestling. It's personality and all that kind of thing. So what were your thoughts taking part in that?
Well, it was strange because obviously no one really knew me. But I was thankful for that, the tournament, because it did give me an opportunity to kind of get my name out there a bit more. And tagging with Rain, it's an unlikely partnership. We'd never spoke before, we never met before, but it worked, and hopefully we're both hoping that at some point down the line we'll get to kind of take that Twitter tournament alliance and bring it to fruition in real life, which I think would be pretty cool to see.
Yeah, so I mean, when that was announced, was it Rain that contacted yourself, or are you heard going, right, this is weird, what are we going to do kind of thing, or is it just, did you hit off kind of straight away?
Yeah, so I mean, I didn't really know what to do. I think she
nobody did.
So I think she messaged me first, and she was like, "So are you good at promos?" And I was like, "Oh, she wants to do a promo," and I'd never done a promo before. But it turns out she wasn't being serious. We were going to do a promo, but for whatever reason, we didn't. I think we could put it. We're going to do one in the next round and I get out. But yeah, we got on really well. We've never met in person, as I said, but yeah, I consider her to be one of my close friend in wrestling, which a year ago I definitely wouldn't have expected, because she's way over
different school, really, different, absolutely different area, and all that kind of stuff as well.
Or opposite, but it works well, and we got on really well. So yeah.
So she did send in a question. She put, "Who's the first team that you know that the two of you are going to beat?" I was going to say Airstrikes probably in there somewhere.
Absolutely, I would enjoy beating up two of them. The two of them, I think Omar Muhammad and any partner of his choosing. him and his wee probably. He was the brunt of some Twitter attacks. That would be fun. I'd love to have a match, singles or as a team with Omar Muhammad. One team I'd love to face is the KOE. They are fantastic. It's great to see them getting our shot in ICW just now. So they are fantastic. But anybody, I'd love to team with Rain at some point in any capacity against anybody. I think that's really cool.
Yeah, KOE at the moment, they really are. It's one of those teams where I've kind of seen, like, in older shows for Source, that see how far they've grown as an act as well. And they're definitely one of the best tag teams to come out of Source, certainly.
Absolutely.
They're getting chances on WWE Network, of all places, which is mind-blowing to think of.
And they are two guys who, both of them have helped me a lot. They're kind of similar height to me, and they helped me with the nutrition side of things, of getting bigger. They helped me in ring a lot, and they're two guys who, they'll be first to admit it, when you meet them, they're not the most charismatic people, and they just switch it on. So they were able to kind of help me in a variety of different areas. Before I debuted, they were always ones that I'll kind of go to. If I've got an idea, I'll bounce it off them. They'll kind of tell me if it's good, bad, and different. And they've just been really helpful over the past kind of year and a bit, 2 years, whatever it was.
So when you think of Source, then another guy that comes to mind would be ADM, Alexander McCallan, who, again, is a big guy, a big, tall guy. So is he another one that you're able to bounce ideas off of for how to work as part of your size?
Yeah, absolutely. He's. I was gonna say it's the two boys, the KOE boys and ADM, have been the two, three most helpful fellow trainees in my journey, if you like. I think ADM's one who anybody can kind of go to, especially within Source. He's the locker room leader, if you like, obviously being the first champion and things like that. And he's very good in the ring. And I knew he was good, but I didn't realise how good he was until I had a training match with him. I was like, he's very, very good. He's another one that's definitely played a big part in my kind of coming up.
So I've got a couple of questions from Darren. You've mentioned him a couple of times now, so I'll go. He's got four, so it's going to be probably quite in depth there. So he's won three matches that you want to have. So who would be your top three opponents? We'll just go for anywhere, any wrestler, any.
You've made it difficult for me. Anywhere. Chris Brooks is one. I'd love to have a match with Chris Brooks. I mean, it's not very likely with him just now, with him being in Japan and that. But Chris Brooks is one. I mean, Randy Orton has to, if I could wrestle anybody in the planet, it would be Randy Orton. And then one kind of more close to home would probably be ADM. I'd love to have a match on an actual show with ADM and Darren, because we were supposed to have that match and it never got to happen. So any of those four matches would be good.
Throw him in there. So he's also put nicest people in wrestling. So we sort of had a good few folk come through for special training classes and what have you. So who's the nicest people you've met in wrestling?
He's got some hard questions. Yeah. I've not met too many people outside Source. Like, I've met a good few people, but I've not had a chance to get to know them. Manlin is probably the first name that comes to mind. Manlin, I'd never spoken to him before, and it's just like you've known him forever. When you talk to him, he's just so easy to talk to. He's always there to kind of point different things out. He's been around for quite a while. Austin Brooks, he's changed his name. Austin Brooks, he's always very bubbly. You know, he's always got a smile on his face. As soon as he comes in, he's just there with big smile and always cheering everybody up. Third person, nicest in wrestling. There's so many. I don't want to like list off every.
It's fine. Like, he didn't give you a number, before. so I'll just say two of them and just everyone. Because I like to keep this podcast positive as possible.
Rain. That has to be Rain on it. Absolutely, have to be Rain on it.
So he also asked 2020 in five words. Of course, it's now 2021, but 2020, the year of rubbish. Describe it in five words.
It was really, really bad. It was really, really bad. I don't think that's what he meant, but that's what he's getting. Yeah.
I think someone's just come into my house, so I was going to be a second while we check that. If you want to plug anything in the meantime, we'll do your social media at the end. I was going to double check that. So it's going to be a second or two.
No problem.
Right, that was my mother-in-law. So I will go back and check just to make sure you haven't just read fan fiction or anything weird. So apologies for that. Mother-in-law dropping off soup. So there's second interview of... It's quite good because the second interview I did in season one, I had to leave the room because my dog decided to play with a squeaky toy and I had to go get it from her. So, you know, just keep it with the theme of just making this is a disaster podcast, but we'll recover it. Darren had another question as well. He had four in total. He had goals for 2021, which is pretty good. So what are your goals for this year?
Wrestle in any capacity is the first one. I think we'll get back in the ring in some capacity this year. It doesn't seem like it now with obviously today the new restrictions coming in. But I do think that we're quite close. It might seem like we're a million miles away, but I do think we'll get back. It's like my goal for last year was just to wrestle as much as possible against as many different people and as many different places as possible. And I think it's the same thing for this year. It's just wrestle as much as I can. Tagging with Rain is one. Just get myself out there a bit more. I didn't really have a chance too much. I had two matches to really get my name out there. So I think to make people more aware of who I am and what I'm about, I think that would be kind of the main, make myself more established on the Scottish wrestling scene. I think that's the main one.
Absolutely. And especially after last year, there's definitely more opportunities and more spots. I mean, there might be less companies or less promotions running shows for whatever reason. But there's definitely more opportunities out there now. I think I've said in previous podcasts, well, my thought is at the very earliest, it's not going to be until autumn this year, 2021. But even then, a lot of companies will be relying on a core roster. So with Source, especially having so many talented guys, I mean, you've got yourself, you've got ADM, you've got Grant McIver, of course, Source Wrestling Champion. Better mention him, unless... because he'll surely point out, I haven't mentioned him if I don't. But you've got so many great guys in Source and girls coming through that you will be relied upon during that first period back. So if you can get some time in the ring, then of course the worlds are oyster from that point.
Absolutely.
Manlon's asked just a mirror question. He also put, you've got a time machine and could book one match with wrestlers from any era. So, not including yourself, just any match, what are you booking?
These questions are good, man.
I know, I'm going to steal some for future podcasts as well.
AJ Styles and Shawn Michaels has to be one. Undertaker and Sting has to be another one. Big Show and Andre the Giant. I'm just kind of trying to take
your classic kind of
I've not got any personal like kind of my favourites that I would like to see in different matches, but yeah, classic matches that the whole world would enjoy.
Yeah, I think that Shawn Michaels AJ style one is going to get closer and closer. If we're going to consider Saudi Arabia being Shawn Michaels' last match. So I was watching that Undertaker documentary and it's just everything that could have went wrong in that match.
Yeah.
So speaking of Scottish wrestling, I mean, 2020 was a humongous year for Scottish wrestling. You got Nikki Cross becoming the first ever two-time women's tag team champion, Alexa Bliss, which I think gets forgotten because of the next one, I'm about to say.
Yeah.
And Drew McIntyre became WWE champion. So with this kind of renewed focus on Scottish wrestling, where do you see yourself? It means your goals you said for next year is just to wrestle. But what's your long-term goal, your five-year plan? Is NXT UK, Japan, AEW, what's your goal?
I mean, I think the end goal for most people coming through just now is to make this their full-time job. And the way to get that is to get signed. As I've always, WWE has always been my... I've always loved watching WWE. It's not been since the last couple of years that I've gotten to different kind of promotions. So to get to WWE and whatever, NXT UK, whatever, that would be surreal. But then again, there's so many different options out there. There's so many different promotions that are doing so well. You've got, like, obviously, as I said, over in Japan, there's AEW, Impact. But yeah, I'd say WWE, if I could choose to go anywhere, it would be WWE.
And so you mentioned Randy Orton as being one of your constant favourites. Who's your favourites just now then? Who's your fave five, as Booker T used to say? Who'd be your fave five right now?
Orton still makes that, obviously. Drew has to come in there as well. Chris Brooks is there too. T-Bar? Is it T-Bar now? T-Bar?
yeah, it is. Yeah, T-Bar.
Actually, no. Dijakovic was, but who else was my favorite just now? Keith Lee, he's another.
Of course, yeah. Those two had some wars. When this whole lockdown thing started, of course, I was able to work from home, so I've been watching TakeOver along with the pay-per-views in the Thunderdome. But yeah, Keith, I've only ever got to see the last one together. on a takeover live, and it's there was just guys that big shouldn't move that well.
It's unbelievable. It's mind blown. Like some of the things they're able to do is just incredible.
And give it a couple of years, and that'll be your cell.
I hope so.
So one of our classic questions, which I'm trying to actually remember to ask this year and this season, is what's your favourite dinosaur?
I wasn't sure if you were going to ask that. I hope so though. Favourite dinosaur? Velociraptor, probably because...
popular choice.
I'd say probably because that was Velociraptor in Step Brothers. That was the dinosaur mentioned. That's the favourite dinosaur of Dale and Brennan. So I'll roll that one.
We've had some. I mean, right now, as of recording, we're doing the year end awards and I've done the podcast awards, and I've been going through the double checking because one of the awards is of course favourite dinosaur, because of course it is, and there's been some odd ones in there, including I haven't written them down. I don't know why I'm looking at my notepad here, but there've been ones like turkey dinosaurs, which I thought was incredible. Harmony Sky sent that one in after the poll went out. I thought that's brilliant. You got Barney, of course. Someone put Mike Musso, which I thought was harsh. Someone put my mum, which hurt my feelings a lot. So if people are listening to this, that was mean. My mum's quite young. So I don't know why that Kevin Williams came up with that dinosaur question, and it seems to be a popular one. We've got a t-shirt on it if anyone's wanting to go on tmail.com, Scott Resnett. So what's your life outside of wrestling then? What's you got any passions, hobbies, or just the darts?
What do I like outside of wrestling? Right now I'm not doing much more else than like school and work. But darts, football's a big one. Football and wrestling are the two main passions in my life. Football's kind of, as much as I gave it up playing, I think I was able to then enjoy it more watching it, because when I was playing and I didn't really like to watch football. For whatever reason, I'm not too sure. But now I can just watch football and actually enjoy it instead of thinking, oh, maybe I'll try that, or I can just relax and watch it.
Oh yeah, so if you're watching wrestling, you're seeing Dijakovic do a mental dive. It's when you're sitting there going, I could probably give that a go. I think it would be you get to school and the first person you see in school, no, we're not. No, I'm not doing it. So you said your style's not the powerhouse, it's that hybrid Dijakovic kind of thing. Is there any moves that you want to try? I know for some reason a lot of trainees want to do a moonsault. That seems to be kind of a one that pops up a lot. Any moves that you're wanting to try and add to your repertoire once lockdown's over and you get back into training?
One I was planning on, I'd added to my repertoire after my second match, was actually the Swanton. I was planning on using that, and I was very excited to use it in the show in April at Mount Vernon, and then it got cancelled. So that was one that I was very excited, because I'd always loved Jeff Hardy. I was like, so cool. I'm very tall, so it'll look weird. And I was like, that'll be cool. And I'm called the Phoenix, so I could come up with an FDU name, Phoenix, you know. But I never got to use it. So hopefully at some point in the future,
Swanton's the plan. Just the thought that if you over jump that, you're going to be your legs and turnbuckles at the other side.
Yeah.
6'6".
Exactly.
I mean, it's a weird time for everyone, and it's great to have guys like yourself and folk that have just started in the wrestling business trying to agree and to put their name out there and speaking to me just about wrestling. We're going to be putting this out about 2 weeks after the Royal Rumble. You're still a WWE watcher. Who's your pick for the Royal Rumble?
Ooh.
And then we can find out in 2 weeks if you're right.
Who's my pick for the Rumble? Oh, that's a tough one. Quite like to say Keith Lee, but I'm not too sure if that. Yeah, you know what? We'll go Keith Lee.
Not T-Bar. T-Bar's not gonna.
No, I don't really see that one happening.
You never. Yeah, unlikely.
To be honest, you never know.
No, exactly. The Royal Rumble is a magical time of year, and one day. So we'll go back to just before we start wrapping things up. Some of your favourite matches, then. So you said you like watching guys like Chris Brooks and what have you. What would be your? You did send me three matches when you did our interview way back at the start of last year, which could have changed. What are your top three favourite matches of all time?
So I think my favourite was Undertaker and Shawn Michaels at what, in fact, either 25 or WrestleMania 26, but I think probably 26. That's definitely one of my favourites. Second, I would probably say WrestleMania 33, which the only reason it's my favourite is because it's when the ladder match, when the Hardys come back.
Yeah.
And I was there, I was mind blown when the lights went purple and the tattoo that came up on the Titantron and the music hit. I could not believe it. I couldn't believe how lucky I was that I got to see. They were finally back. So I'd say that match purely for that value. Third favorite sporting. Cena and Punk at Money in the Bank. That's the, yeah.
So I'll try. So you're actually at WrestleMania, that WrestleMania 33.
I was. It was a complete, I didn't go to Florida for WrestleMania. The holiday was booked for Orlando and I was sat watching WrestleMania 32 and they do the thing where it's like, here's where we'll be next year. And it came up Orlando and I was like, no way. And I checked the dates and we landed in Orlando the day before. And I was like, Dad, any chance we could go to WrestleMania? And we did. And it was absolutely fantastic. I couldn't believe how lucky I was for that. And Taker lost as well. So it was a very eventful WrestleMania.
That's just a crazy coincidence, that destiny kind of thing. It just happened to be the date you were going to there. So, I mean, where did you, were you top tier nosebleeds or did you get quite close to the front?
That's a question, that is. We missed the ticket release from WWE. So, this, bear in mind, this was like an 80,000 seater stadium. We were two rows from the back out of the whole stadium. Now, I struggle with heights, which is quite ironic being 6'6". So, and for the security of it didn't seem very secure. There wasn't like seats, it was like just concrete benches. We went up the escalator and there was like, you could literally see down to the hundreds of feet below. So I got up to the top and it was Pac or Neville and Austin Aries. They were just starting and Pac was making his entrance. And we were up the back and I was already like caged in. And of course the fireworks went off and I was like lying, clutching onto this handle. I was like, there's no way. It was like a helicopter that films like the whole arena, and you could see the driver's, the pilot's face. He was like, it was so high. And I was like, I can't believe I finally got here and I'm not going to be able to sit here. But thankfully, we made our way down nearer the ring where you could actually see the wrestlers. And we stood, so we actually got a very good view. Thankfully, we were allowed to just kind of stand at the back, which we had a great view. So yeah, it started off bad, but it definitely got.
Just you describing the escalator, my arse was just coming out of me. I was saying, oh God. I mean, I'm not scared of heights, but just the thought of it, going up an escalator to go to the top of an arena.
I couldn't believe it. I had to sit so that I couldn't see, like, over the... like, when I say I'm scared of heights, I'm terrified of heights. So it wasn't a good combination.
So, I mean, thank God you weren't there for Undertaker's match then, because Roman had that humongous circle at the end, didn't he? Thought of it. Wow. Right, so we'll get one of the tall questions just in, because I'm going to ask, how's the weather up there? Question's been asked a million times.
Yeah, so see, I always say this, see if someone comes up with like an original tall person like joke or question, I'm so impressed, because it's always like, what's the weather up there? You must be good at basketball. Do you play basketball? What does a giraffe's head look like? And all that ridiculous stuff.
Never heard that last one. I'm keeping that.
If someone comes up to me and gives me something I've never heard, they're very good.
Giraffes. That one's tough. I'm writing that one down for future use. That's amazing. Right. Okay. So, we'll wrap up our chat now. Hopefully next time we actually do this and we're into season 3 or 4, there'll actually be matches. We'll be able to speak about your series of matches with Airstrike and Darren Blair and ripping up the tag team scene with Rain. In the meantime, if people need to find you, where can they find you on social media?
I am on Twitter and Instagram at the Colton Davis, so you can find me on both of there.
Excellent. Great. Well, thank you very much for joining me on this episode of the SWN podcast. Hopefully we'll see Keith Lee win the Royal Rumble, and then you can be super smug when you've predicted it a month before the show actually takes place. But thank you again.
Thank you very much for having me, Billy. Thank you very much.
No worries at all. Enjoyed it. Thanks.